Well, good evening, friends. Welcome to another episode of Healthy Pastors, Healthy Churches. Tonight we are talking about the topic of building a culture of ministry health. And tonight I am once again joined by my friend Roy Yanke. Roy is actually going to switch seats tonight rather than being a co-host with me. He is our presenter on this topic, and this is something that he knows dearly from the inside and out. Looking forward to hearing what he has to say to us. Roy, if you're not familiar with him, is a ruling elder in the EPC. He's a member of the Effective Biblical Leadership Team, so I'm blessed to work very closely with him in that connection. And he also serves as the Executive Director of PIR Ministries. So with all of that background, Roy, thank you so much for being here once again.
My pleasure.
Would love for you to go ahead and introduce this topic. Oh, but before you do, friends, do want to let you know, you will have opportunity to ask Roy some questions interacting with the material he shares with us tonight. So after he presents to us on this topic of building a culture of ministry health, I'll have a few follow-up questions for him, I'm sure. And then I'm sure you will as well. So at any time during the presentation, if you would like to ask a question, just drop it into that Q&A toward the bottom of your Zoom window there. And toward the end, we'll have a chance to interact with Roy around this theme. So Roy, thank you once again, and go ahead and take it away.
Well, thanks, Annie. And it has been through this year, as we've gone through these webinars, a pleasure to work with you. It's a pleasure to work with you on the Effective Biblical Leadership Team. You do an awesome job. And so as we wrap this series up for the year, I want to share with you that are listening and watching tonight a topic that we are pretty passionate about with PIR Ministries, and something that has grown out of our own experiences as pastors. Those of us who are on staff are all pastors and former pastors, around the culture of leadership in the church and how to cultivate a culture of ministry health. That's the title of this workshop. We have done this in various settings, and so this is going to be a little bit of a truncated version because normally it would give us opportunity to split off into breakout groups, and ruling elders and teaching elders would go into separate rooms and talk together around some of these topics. But we're going to leave that to you and hope that you will carry on the conversation after this is done, because that's really what this workshop is about. And so I'm going to share my screen, if that's all right, with you, Annie, and we will get started. So,
sounds great.
All right. So this is a workshop that we've done a number of times, as I've said, and we title it specifically Cultivating a Culture of Ministry Health, because as we will talk about in a little bit, ministry health and a culture of that is something that is organic. It cannot be programmed. And that's why we titled it this way. So the question to begin with then is a question for all of you to consider. You know, what would it feel like to serve in a church where life, leadership, and ministry are flourishing in Christ? Where the culture of ministry was healthy? I think this is the environment that we would all love to worship and serve in and minister out of, where there's a healthy context for ministry and a healthy approach to ministry, but it may or may not be for you. And our goal tonight, my goal tonight, is to attempt to be a catalyst for you, whether you're a teaching elder listening and watching or a ruling elder listening or watching, that you would have the conversations that are required to begin this process of developing and cultivating this kind of culture in your church. I want to stimulate you to have these conversations that allow you to examine the ministry culture that you currently have in your church, and then to begin that process of cultivating a culture that is healthy by strengthening particularly your leadership relationships. And that's the big thing here that stands behind everything I'm going to say, is that as you have those conversations as leaders, your leadership relationships are being strengthened, which becomes, as I will tell you later, the foundation for cultivating this kind of culture. Now, COVID, we can't help but keep talking about COVID sometimes because it's had a huge impact on all of our lives and all of our church lives. It's revealed in many ways what was already present. It didn't create what was there. It just simply brought to the surface in our experience, particularly revealing the contexts and the culture out of which ministry and church life have been built, and how they come out of those contexts and cultures, and then also how resilient and sustainable we are. That's a question for us coming out of this time. So the first thing we want to do in creating that picture, if you will, of that church where ministry health and the culture is healthy, is let's talk about culture, okay? A culture, simply put, is the way of life that defines a people group, the norms and expressions of who they are. And there is a culture in every church, even if we haven't identified it. And it operates and influences everything that we do, regardless of whether we have spent any time discussing or defining it or exploring it. I love the fact that there's a lot of evidence for this in the writings of many people. The church called Tove, Scott McKnight and Laura Berenger talk about culture and leadership culture this way. They say, like any organization, every church is distinct in its culture, formed and nurtured and perpetuated by the ongoing interaction of leaders and the congregation. Organizations function in the same way as individuals. That is, their habits form their personality. And every church has a personality and a culture that lives behind that personality. And culture in reality is both manageable and dynamic. It is not something that likes to stay put. It is something that we can invest in, that we can explore, that we can create ways in which to develop a culture. But it's very dynamic because it's dependent on all of the individuals who contribute to that. And so everybody, as we'll see later, has to share in the development of that culture. As Scott Chan says, he says, the atmosphere in which the church functions is culture. It is the prevalent attitude, the collage, and I love that term, of spoken and unspoken messages. That's important. It's the way we do things around here, quote unquote, you know, and that's a common term we often hear. So culture is extremely important. It's like the operating system on your phone or the computer that you're watching this on. Peter Drucker is quoted as saying, and some dispute whether he said it or not, it doesn't matter because it's a great saying regardless. Culture eats strategy and mission for breakfast, and I like to put on the end of that and a snack. It's something that can hijack the best strategic plans that we put in place and the best mission statements and sense of mission that we have, because culture is deeply embedded in the relationships that we have together and how we go about things. And sometimes that's really difficult to uncover if we aren't intentional about that. Now, there are some biblical examples, and I just highlight these. We won't spend a lot of time here. We can look at the church in Corinth when Paul was writing to the church, and we can pretty quickly identify that that culture was unhealthy. There was a lot of stuff going on, and a lot of discussions and debates and dialogue and controversies and conflicts that certainly define the culture as unhealthy in that church. On the other hand, Paul writes with exuberance and joy, which is a hallmark of the book of the Philippians, to the church of Philippi. Now, a pretty healthy church overall. They were handling life together and life in Christ pretty well, and the culture represented that. So there's a culture that exists. The church you're a part of and the leadership relationships that you have, there's a culture that's there. And the important thing for us to do is to explore that, define it, and then see if it's healthy or not. And then figure out if it's not, how can we move it in that direction? So our target in this is ministry health, a culture of ministry health. It's an environment where life, leaders, and ministry flourish in Christ. It's really important to just unpack that a bit of, because it's a culture, it's not a program. It's organic, it's not a program. And a culture is pervasive. You can think about it this way. It's like the ecosystem of well-being that is based on how we impact each other for good or for bad. So we shape the culture together, and it is the ecosystem, the environment, the organic systems that we work in leadership and in the church. And so what we want to get at in this is the well-being of those who serve, that it is thriving, it is healthy, spiritually, emotionally, socially, and physically. So it's important to understand that we're not just talking about having all of our theology in nice, neat orders and having all the information that we need parsed out quite well. This goes to the whole nature of who we are as human beings and who we are as human beings together in a community, and that includes all of those dimensions. So we're looking at ministry health is thriving well-being of those who are in relationship with one another in leadership, particularly. It's a quality rather than a quantity of life. And it's for all leaders. It doesn't stop at the session and the pastor. It goes to all the leadership, certainly in the church, and eventually it will spill over into the congregation. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. So ministry, if this is true, flows from who we are in Christ together, that we're sharing his life together. We are thriving and flourishing in these dimensions, and the environment, the ecosystem that we lead in, that we serve in, is a healthy one. It has that quality to it. So the place to begin with this, obviously, is what's wrong, okay? If we feel like maybe we're not like this and we wish we were, then the first step is to do a little bit of diagnosis. What's missing? Where are we now that would help us understand where we need to go? So here are some signs of an unhealthy ministry culture. So the first one is isolation and isolating. When we work with pastors, we find that this dimension is pretty prevalent, especially when it comes to geography a lot of times, but also personality-wise, pastors often feel isolated. But isolating can also happen within the leadership relationships where people really are keeping each other at arm's length, that they are not known to one another. And even though they're present around a session table or in the fellowship hall or wherever it is, they really are not connected. They are apart and they are not sharing that life together. They are holding back who they are. They do not feel like they can connect well with each other. And so isolation occurs. As an introvert, I can be alone in a crowd. And so there's that dimension of, because it's me and my personality and the way I operate, I can experience isolation even when I'm surrounded by people. And that's true of leadership relationships in the church. So it isn't just a singular person's personality trait. So is there an unwillingness or an inability to engage relationally? That's the question when it comes to isolation and isolating. Are we unwilling or are we unable, for a number of reasons, to engage relationally? The other one is burnout. And we talk about that a lot with pastors, but it occurs with ministry leaders in general as well. It's not limited to pastors. If there's a sense of that the things around the table of, in our church, in our ministries, are never going to change and never get any better, so we have that disappointment spirit all the time, that can quickly lead to burnout, where people are just going through the motions, they're trying to keep pushing forward, and they're finding the law of diminishing returns taking place, where the energy that's inputted into the system begins to diminish over time because we're not seeing the results, we're not feeling what we hope and need to feel in those systems. Then there's the prevalence of the push and pull to produce. Are we always trying to make things happen? We are always in the mode of getting things done. Our mantra, even if it's unspoken, is more and bigger is better. And that is insidious, because that will certainly cycle back into burnout very quickly if we're always putting the pedal to the metal. And we have to produce, we have to give evidence that we are achieving things. That's a very difficult thing to maintain, and it definitely contributes to an unhealthy culture in the church. The next one is unresolved conflict. Are there repetitive issues that are always sabotaging our ability to work together? Things just keep coming up over and over again in meetings and conversations where we just can't get past them. Do we allow the differences in opinion to become deeply rooted positions? So we begin to plant our stakes in the ground. And whenever that topic, or whenever there's a sense that things are uncomfortable, those are the things that we circle around and come back to over and over again. And so conflict is unresolved. We never actually address the issues or the positions. Now, certainly moral compromise is a definite sign of unhealth in a ministry culture among leaders. And sometimes that can even look simply like a willingness to cut corners in accountability, that we will not actually hold each other accountable for things we say we will do, or postures that we will have, and ways we will go about the leading of the church. That's a moral compromise. That's a compromise of my ethic, if you will, of the relationships that we're supposed to have in the body of Christ. Here's the other thing about moral compromise. Does competency allow us to ignore character? Does someone bring to the table a whole bunch of skills that we would really like to see brought to the fore in the work of the church, but character is somehow lacking? And a lot of times we will sacrifice that. We will sacrifice the character issue for the sake of competency. And that's truly a moral compromise. In other words, disunity in factions, obviously, is there an increasing loss of the sense of usness, of being together in this? Are certain people and their influence allowed to become a priority? When that happens, and you see that in some of the letters that Paul wrote to the churches, that there were factions in the churches, and that's because these people were allowed to become, in their positions, a priority over the shared and oneness that are supposed to be in those leadership relationships. And then there's leadership entitlement. And this is one that doesn't get talked about a lot. We drift into apathy as perhaps ruling elders or staff people under a pastor or ministry leaders under staff members, because we are marginalized. We have a sense of being marginalized. The ministry is not shared. There's one person who's kind of driving the bus, and it's not a collaborative effort. And if the pastor or staff person or ministry leader has become the only voice that matters, then leadership entitlement is in place. And that contributes to an unhealthy church culture. Now, to dive in a little bit more deeply, Patrick Lencioni, in his book, Five Dysfunctions of a Team, lays out this pyramid that is really helpful for us to identify a little bit even more the unhealth that can exist. So at the bottom, the more foundational piece of that pyramid is trust. And the absence of trust in a team, in a leadership team, leads to invulnerability or a sense of non-vulnerability. We will not share who we really are. We will not talk about the fact that we, even though we might present as all that in a bag of chips, we really aren't. And we won't go there for the fear of being known in a way that we are not comfortable with. And so with there, if there's no trust among leaders in a leadership culture or setting, then people are not known. Isolation certainly can occur. You begin to go down the spiral of unhealth. The next one up is fear of conflict, which then translates into an artificial harmony where everybody's just being nice, okay? And niceness is the enemy of reality and of getting things right in the church and in a culture that wants to be healthy. Just to play nice together doesn't mean that you're healthy. It means sometimes that you're simply unwilling and fearful of addressing the issues in the room, and fear of conflict will drive the spirit of unhealth. There are other ones. A lack of commitment leads to ambiguity. Avoiding accountability means that you just keep lowering the standards. And if there's an inattention to results, everything is driven by status and ego in an unhealthy culture and a dysfunctional team. So those bottom two are really important when it comes to developing a ministry culture that is healthy. In reverse, trust and the ability to engage with conflict. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. So those are the signs of an unhealthy church culture. There probably are more, but those are the ones that we see often that certainly I have experienced, and you probably have too in some form or fashion. Now, what are some signs of a growing culture of ministry health? All right, so we talked about all the yucky stuff. Well, let's talk about the good stuff and where we would love to be in that environment of ministry health. Well, the first one is trust. Again, the bottom piece of that pyramid in reverse is not the absence of trust, but that trust exists. And nothing is more important to cultivating this kind of ministry culture than the relationships that we have as leaders, and trust is foundational and becomes the springboard to leading together in health. If you don't have this piece, you can strategize, you can program, you can do everything you think of, but it will ultimately show up cracks in the leadership relationships that could lead to fault lines that can lead to unhealth. Positively stated, the bottom line of Lencioni's pyramid is that trust is there, that we trust one another, that we are able to have safe and honest communication with one another. We trust each other enough. And again, without this, disunity and factions come up. There's no sense of usness in the room and in the work that we're doing. And we can feel marginalized because somebody else is driving the bus and there's no collaboration. So trust is really, really important. And if it's there, if trust is there, then it allows for the gift of responsiveness to one another. And an element of trust is a dynamic force when it comes to creating a healthy culture and leadership. Let me give you an example. When I was pastoring, I was called to go to a redevelopment work where we were combining three congregations into one. And when we took this over, when my wife and I stepped into this role, we were engaged with a church of about 10 to 15 people, if I remember right, all over the age of 65. And we were bringing in young families from other places where we had served in churches. So it was the suburban Detroit area. Well, we engaged with the redevelopment process, which included doing a lot of reworking of the building and the landscaping. So we were cleaning things up. We were on the front edge of tearing out pews and putting in chairs. All the things that were really popular back in the 80s and early 90s, okay, when churches were going through these changes. So we cleaned it up, we put in new carpeting, chairs, the whole thing. Just completely different. On the launch Sunday, we had a lady come to the church who was a snowbird. She'd been a member of the church for a long time, arrived at the back of the sanctuary, and she was greeted by my one elder that I had at that point in time, 85-year-old Mr. Petrie. This lady looked around while she was standing there with him and said, "What happened?" And you can, I'm not capturing the tone exactly, but what happened? Everything changed. And my dear brother, 85 years old, looked at her and said, "Nothing happened. That's why we changed." That was a demonstration of trust that he was willing to say, because of what we had been able to do together to launch this new work, there was trust there. And that flourished for us in those leadership relationships. So trust is the foundation. You have to have it if you want to have a healthy leadership and ministry culture. The second thing that we need to make sure is there, if it's going to be healthy, is that our values are becoming clearer. We're able to ask questions that reveal what we actually believe to be important versus what we say we value. I don't know if you've experienced this or not, but around a leadership table, we can say a lot of things, and sometimes it isn't exactly what we believe to be true. And that will show up later, in usually very difficult ways. So, for example, we talk about grace a lot, right? Grace is an important theological, spiritual principle. We talk about it all the time. The question is, what do we do when we fail? When decisions are bad and mistakes are made? Is it possible to adopt the ministry of overlooking faults? Now, we'll talk about this maybe a little bit later in Q&A, because I'm sure you're raising the question about, well, what about, ethical compromise and moral compromise? Yeah, there's a different story there. Grace is still involved. But most cases, we will not extend grace to one another around the simplest things. And they become really big deals in relationships, causing a lot of tension and stress. So grace is just an example of our values becoming clearer in a healthy culture, because we're able to actually talk about those things and really mean what we say and exhibit that around the table. So again, character ought to precede competency in this area. Our value should be that character is the most important thing when it comes to leadership in the church. Competency will follow that. Competency can be increased, and skills can be learned and training can happen, but you cannot do that with character unless you have a very serious discipleship program. And we've all seen the current stories, big and small, of pastors and leaders in churches who have fallen off the rails because competency was valued more than character. So values are clear in a healthy ministry culture. The next one is we listen well and talk less. A lot of conversations around the table and in ministry leaderships and in the work that we do as a church. I love what Winston Churchill said. Courage is what it takes to stand up and speak, and it's also what it takes to sit down and listen, which we don't do a lot. There's lots of talking in our cultures, in the church, not a lot of listening. And listening involves listening with active ears. Leadership involves active listening. We have to actually lean in and engage with someone and ask questions for clarification and be curious about why someone is saying what they're doing, what they're saying, and curious about what the motivations might be. In many ways, listening is a true sign of hospitality toward one another. And that's a really key leadership quality, is that spirit of hospitality. I think that Paul talks about that. I'm not sure. So listen well and talk less. There's more listening in around the table than a lot of talking. This is from Stephen Maccia in The Discerning Life. And I love this statement that he made. Listening to one another is the heartbeat of a healthy, spiritually discerning community. The fruit of listening is a culture of grace, where kindness, patience, and forgiveness reign supreme. How we interact with one another is far more important than what we do together. However, when relationships are vibrant, the work and witness bears fruit that lasts. So very important that posture of listening is in place. Now, here's the next thing that really is the fly in the ointment sometimes, because this particular sign of health can it can really corrode the trust that we're trying to build around the table as leaders. We become more comfortable inviting conflict to shape our discernment process. Now, that may be a totally counterintuitive concept to you, and it was for me for a long time as well. You remember, Lencioni says the fear of conflict forces artificial harmony. All conflict is not bad. How we view it can be, if we're conflict avoidant, or we are in denial, or we want to just not play in that box of sand at all. David Rohrer, in his book, The Sacred Wilderness of Pastoral Ministry, he identifies the temptations we face when we try to avoid conflict. And here's what he says. I love this. He says, we default to either fight or flight. Fear or flight can lead us to become the fixer-upper, the redeemer of all things negative. We confuse peacekeeping with peacemaking. Becoming a warrior, which is the fight side, requires us to win and establish that we are right. As a result, we can and often do creep into narcissism, where it's all about us and our position and what we want to accomplish, what we want to say, what we want to do. He goes on to say, if avoidance of controversy and the maintenance of appearance of stability are your highest aim, then you will never go far in leading people into the truth. That's so important. We cannot dance around this. We need to invite conflict in and make it a tool. Befriend it and use it in a way that helps us move forward in our discerning processes and in building that culture of ministry health, because it can result in new outlooks and options and resilience in the face of challenges. We've seen this time and time again, and certainly in the leadership roles I've been in, we have not avoided conflict. Now, I will tell you, it is messy. You know that. It's not going to be a pretty picture. But if you can be humane and gracious, even be strong in those positions you have, but still have that active listening and curiosity toward others, then conflict can be a friend and a great tool in building a culture of ministry health. Unresolved conflict is the number one reason for unplanned exits of pastors from the churches. Has been for years and still is the case. So we need to make it our friend. Here's another sign of a culture of ministry health, that leadership is actually a joy and not a burden. So you look around, and the people smile. There's probably humor around the table and a willingness to joke around and be human in that way. There's contentment. There's a sense of significance and purposefulness about what we're doing. And we see it on the faces of people, and certainly in their attitudes. So Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 2:19, "For what is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at his coming?" Really good question. What is it that we can be proud of? What is it that we can trumpet and celebrate? Is it not you? For you are our glory and joy. Now, I've never heard that applied directly to leadership relationships, ever. But I do believe it's an important place to get to, where we can look across the table, we can look across the room as we're serving with someone and go, this is awesome. And we are delighted, and there's contentment and a sense of significance about it. And there's a sense in which also that if leaders are cared for and supported, and self-care is being practiced, not only by pastors, but other leaders, and encouraged, then there's that sense of joy that what we're doing is not just trying to make stuff happen, but we are leaning strongly into the sovereignty of our God, the leading of the Holy Spirit, and the gospel that says we don't have to earn even the merit of our church life. We don't have to earn that. We have to find out how to lead in a healthy way. And that also involves clear expectations and boundaries. We want to be able to set those in order for leadership to be a joy, that we are not overly committing people on it, even in an unknown way, that we communicate that people need to be doing more because they should be. So I, as a pastor for a long time, unfortunately, I lived in the land of the shoulds and oughts, and it was applied specifically to the people of my church, the congregation. They should be doing this. How come they haven't done that? They ought to be on time. And you could just run the list. And that's not a healthy posture. That does not contribute to a culture of ministry health. It didn't bring joy to anybody, including me. So these are some of the signs. And it's, again, not an exhaustive list, but the ones that we certainly have seen when churches and leadership is functioning in a healthy way, that culture is there. These are the things that tend to show up. So we've talked about all of this. So then the real big deal then is cultivating. How do we actually get here, right? Let's put some shoe leather on this. Three keys to cultivating a culture of ministry health. The big idea here is this: the intentional activity of ongoing collaborative conversation among church leadership. Say that again, because I stumbled a little bit. The intentional activity of ongoing collaborative conversation among church leadership with the aim of ministry health as a significant part of the overall church culture. A lot of pieces there that we're going to unpack right now. All right. The first thing that we need to do, and this is be aware. This is the first key of the three. If we're going to involve ourselves in the intentional activity of collaborative conversation, we have to take the measure of where we are first. So there has to be awareness. The first question that we need to ask is our church a good and safe place in which to be a ministry leader? That's a serious question. And it's a question that evokes awareness. So I want you to just take a moment here. I'm not going to take long, but I want you to stop for a minute listening to me. And I want you to take a piece of paper if you didn't have one already. And I want you to write down the answer to this question in regard to your church and the culture that you have. Is it a good and safe place in which to be a ministry leader? Yes or no? Just write one or the other word. No one else is going to see that. Just you. But it is the first step in awareness. We have to examine our culture of ministry health. It's like in a laboratory, taking a peek in the petri dish and seeing what's growing there. Is it good or is it not? Okay. So we have to spend the time becoming more aware of where we actually are. Some of those signs of unhealth, are they there? Some of the signs of health, are they there? What's really going on among us? Okay. Take a patient, hard, honest look at the landscape of ministry and the state of your congregation's culture for ministry. Open up that petri dish. It's a patient thing and an honest thing that you have to do here. So here's another question for you. I think I have it in the right spot. Yes, here we are. You need to do this as well right now. I'm going to give you another minute or two to do this. What animal would you use to describe the current culture of ministry at your church? What is it and why? I want you to write it down. Any animal that comes to mind that would describe what that current culture of ministry health is as you experience it. You don't have to go into a long explanation of why, but I think you probably know why if you've picked an animal that describes that. Okay. I will tell you that the answers we have gotten for this have been hilarious sometimes, but also very telling. One time when we did this workshop, someone said roadkill. So. There
Yeah,
you go.
that's not what you want to hear.
No, it is not. It is not. But if that describes their experience of the culture, then it is a worthy description to explore. So hang on to this. We'll come back to this in a minute. All right. The second key to this culture, cultivating this culture of ministry health, is the idea of partnership. Our leadership relationships. This is really what it boils down to. Because leadership is the chief catalyst for a healthy ministry culture. It starts with us, whether it's TEs or REs. We have to be the ones to see this as a partnership together to create this kind of culture out of which life and ministry flourish for the glory of Jesus. Cultivating a culture of resilience and health in ministry. I want you to hear this. So this is for my RE brothers and sisters, all right? This cannot happen if the pastor is doing this work alone. They cannot make it happen. Just like any chemical reaction, it involves more things than just one piece. There are other things that contribute that make that work. And so it has to be a partnership. And it begins to take shape in the relationships of pastors and leaders. And then it moves into the overall life of the church. If it doesn't happen around the table, if it doesn't happen in the leadership context, then it's never going to overflow and be seen in the life of the congregation. So then the second question we need to ask, the first question was, are we a good and safe place? This is the second question. How can we, as pastors and lay leaders, TEs and REs together, share in cultivating that culture of ministry health? How can we do that? So, another piece of self-awareness here. Are our leadership relationships a source of dysfunction that hinders health, or do they set the stage for effective ministry? So let me ask you this, if I may. What do you think results from leadership relationships that are adversarial rather than hospitable, where there is no sense of partnership or collaboration? Well, I can't hear you at this point, so I will sort of answer. Maybe some of these fit for you. There's tension. There is control. There are moves around power and conflict. Now, fortunately, we do know that Jesus also had this going on among his disciples. But being Jesus, he figured out a way for it to become a partnership. and so can we. All right. Jesus and James and John were often in this kind of a triangle of an adversarial kind of relationship. And not intentionally, I'm sure, but just by personality. And it had to be addressed. So we want to make sure that we're moving in the direction of partnership. Here's the other thing. Are we a business only in our approach to doing ministry and leadership? We are running the show rather than shepherding together. Hebrews 13, 17 is very telling for all of us in leadership positions, TEs and REs. The writer of Hebrews says that we are called to watch over the souls entrusted to us. That's our primary function. And unfortunately, the business-only posture and attitude and approach dominates in far too many churches, and it runs counter to what we know, I think we all know, what the church is really meant to be. Nothing wrong with good, sound leadership principles, but when they are the only thing that's dominating the relationships, it's not living out that culture of health that says we are shepherds and keepers and overseers of souls. And that's important to make that distinction. If the sense of partnership doesn't exist, then strong leadership relationships cannot form. They just can't. There has to be that sense of collaboration and shared partnership. This is pastors and elders and ministry leaders owning together responsibility for having a culture of ministry health. We own this together. I want you to see that again. This is everybody. This is an all-in project for everyone. Now, I'm going to get a little bit more specific under this one. Five critical principles. You know, when they're teaching you to preach, you should never do this. You know, have three big ideas, five critical principles. You should never do that.
We'll allow it, Roy.
Okay, thanks. So these really are critical to that sense of partnership building, all right? There has to be a commitment to mutual submission under the lordship of Christ. Do you remember your vows when you became a TE or an RE? Do you promise subjection to your fellow presbyters in the Lord? Wow. Does that one go out the window sometimes in a hurry? So we have to reinforce, restate, recommit to this mutual submission under the lordship of Christ, that we are all under his lordship. The ground is level there, and that's where we have to start from. And it's really hard. It requires a posture of humility and respect for one another, that I am not all that there is, and that others are just as important and valuable. Then there is the hospitality of heart and mind towards one another. I've been captured for a long time about the spirit, this idea of hospitality. It translates into so many important areas. And one of these is leadership relationships and how we are with one another, that we have hospitality of heart and mind toward. We have made space and room for one another rather than hanging out the no vacancy sign. We are creating that place where other people can find a place in our lives, their voice can be heard, that what they offer and who they are is valuable and important. This leads, I hope, and I've seen this sometimes, to a gospel reasonableness regarding our opinions and ideas. When we have that sense of hospitality toward one another, then we can be much more reasonable under the gospel and with the gospel in mind toward one another and our ideas and opinions. So the third one is acknowledge and protect each other's humanity. This includes our brokenness and our limits. And boy, we sometimes will shy away from this in a hurry. We will not allow for someone else to be a human being, nor will we often allow ourselves to be human beings who are broken and in the process of recovery through the gracious work of the Spirit and God's word in our lives. And we do have limits. Sometimes we will overpromise. Sometimes we'll underestimate what's really required. We are all sheep. Mistakes, stress, and the challenges of life have to be allowed. I've learned that having lived in the land of shoulds and oughts for a long time, coming out of that, being a recovering shoulder and oughter, that when life situations happen, because they happen to me too, and they have happened, we have to make gracious allowances for those things and protect each other's humanities and acknowledge sometimes people need to stop or a different direction needs to happen. We have to guard each other's time, the need for rest, and to know when it's time to pause and not push anymore. So, we are humans, growing into everything that God wants us to be by his work in our lives, but we still have limits, and we still need to watch out for one another to make sure those limits are not exceeded. The fourth thing is to encourage each other's growth as disciples. Again, back to that business approach to leadership all being the dominant feature, that can wipe this piece out, because all we're after then is getting plans done, tasks accomplished, strategies implemented, programs happening, the finances are all in order, you know, everybody's in their place. And we forget that as leaders, we are still disciples, that we are still growing in our relationship with Jesus. We still have to sit at his feet, and better sometimes to sit at his feet together. Our discipleship is our first call. And whether we like to acknowledge it or not, Jesus didn't die for our ministry. He died for us, for our lives, for our souls. And our relationship with him is the root of anything we do for him. So we need to encourage each other in spiritual and in life rhythms, things like Sabbath rest, family, marriage. I will throw in sabbaticals for pastors in case you're listening. We have to consider the growth of each other as disciples. And this goes beyond, and I'm not dissing, because I've been there. And when I was sitting around the table as a ruling elder, we did Bible studies, but we also did book studies. And we also spent a lot of time together. And we were able to provoke one another to love and good deeds, encourage each other when the courage was gone, to step forward and into things that were uncomfortable and hard. We built relationships that this principle was certainly a key one, if not front and center, that we were continuing to stimulate one another in our discipleship. The last one is to build an environment of safety and vulnerability, as well as accountability. Accountability can sometimes actually hijack safety and vulnerability. If all we're doing is checking a list and we're asking each other, well, how are you doing? And we get the typical answers, and we've not created an environment of safety and vulnerability, then accountability is just us playing nice and actually avoiding the truth sometimes. Paul Tripp says this: if we are afraid to confess sin or admit mistakes before what should be the most spiritually mature community in the church, which is the leadership community, we are sadly living in a state of functional gospel amnesia, no matter how robust our theological grasp of the gospel is. I believe that 100%. Far too often we have seen pastors, ruling elders, other ministry leaders, unable to address real spiritual, emotional, mental challenges and issues because of the fear of how they will be judged and even jettisoned from those leadership relationships and maybe even the church. We need to be advocates for one another. We need to advocate the grace of God to one another and advocate on behalf of one another before the great advocate of our souls. We have worked with several pastors who had the audacity to admit that they struggled with depression. And in both cases, those pastors were dismissed summarily. That is a sad, hurtful testimony to what we say we believe about the gospel and about the community of faith. Our session should be, living in the land of shoulds again, the safest place in the world to do what James talks about in James chapter 5, to confess our faults to one another and pray for one another that we may be healed. So this is a critical principle as well. So the third key, we've talked about two keys and five critical principles. Now we're going to get to the last key, all right? So we've talked about intention, we've talked about awareness, and we've talked about partnership. Now we're talking about intentionality. Culture needs to be created, shaped, and maintained. And the maintenance part of this is important. We need to be able to make sure that this culture is robust and that it continues to receive the attention that it needs to stay robust. So there has to be intentionality in building this culture and cultivating it. And the first thing that begins with is, are we unified in our resolve to be a vibrant and resilient church? Okay. Are we willing to do that? Okay. So we have to identify constraints. Cultivating this kind of culture doesn't happen automatically or without hurdles. There are so many challenges to this culture of ministry health, whether it's COVID before, during, or after. All the normal stuff of church life can just really create barriers to this culture of ministry health. We endure conflict, try to maintain unity. Certainly over the last several years, there's been decision fatigue. All these things can just really throttle this culture developing. And inertia is always tugging at our heels. We're always like, do I have to put more energy into this? Do I have to keep working at this? Yeah. Impatience is also another challenge, a constraint here. It takes time, and we struggle with the slow work of God. We want, if we're going to do this, we want a book and a workbook and 6 weeks to make it happen. And I will tell you that it took pretty close to 15 years for the church I was a part of as a ruling elder to achieve even a segment of this kind of culture. We worked at it, and it was hard work, but it was good work. And ministry has always been demanding, and it continues to be, right? And we're doing eternal, significant work, whether you're a ruling elder or a teaching elder. This work can be intense sometimes. And so ministry health, maintaining that can be a significant challenge because sometimes we can just flat out get tired. But we have to be committed to this principle. So let me remind you of the big idea. This is the intentional activity of collaborative conversation among church leaders aimed at making ministry health a core value of the church's culture. And identifying constraints is a big part of that. So we just got to figure out what are the things that are going to impede us? What are the things that are going to be challenges that are going to keep us from becoming this way in leadership? The other thing is that we have to be committed to continuous improvement. This comes out of my experience in the quality world. This is never a one and done kind of thing. There's always continuous improvement that we can make in this area. We work at it. It's a process. It's an organic thing that we're dealing with, sort of like tending your garden. I would love that the weeds would never come back, but they do. So we have to be willing to do this. I'm a Detroit Tigers fan. And one of our star, Miguel Cabrera, retired a year ago. And what was really interesting was when I found out that on the day he retired his last game ever, he still took batting practice. That's a commitment to continuous improvement, even on the last day. All right. So we have to be involved in this. And the last thing here is that we have to give grace to fail and start again amid the challenges, the missteps, and the wounds that can occur in this process. Our intentionality has to include intentional grace, that we're willing to say, yep, we sidestepped here. Yep, it isn't working quite well here. We're going to keep at it. We're not going to jettison it. This is important because it impacts the life of our congregation and our willingness and ability to share the gospel with the world in real ways. So, what's the result of all of this? Well, our church can be a place where life, leaders, and ministry flourish in Christ, that people are actually flourishing and life is flourishing, and not just ministry. That it's the whole of who we are in Christ together. Here are some things that might happen, actually. Expectations are clear. We work hard at communication, and there's trust, and there's intentionality, and we're willing to take the time to make sure everybody understands the expectations, and there are no hidden agendas. Patience and trust are fostered. We are patient and trusting of one another. And love and grace are modeled and experienced in those hard and difficult places. And issues can be honestly and graciously addressed and solved, that we're not going to deny or deflect or step around, but we're actually going to lean in and make conflict work for us. But the presence of Jesus becomes unhindered. I don't know, maybe that's not what you want. You know, that Jesus has got his hands tied because we haven't worked this out. But if we will pursue it, then his presence will be unhindered among us. And there's freedom to explore the opportunities that God provides without the fear of failure. We can try things and go, yeah, that didn't work for us. You know, in our ministry several years ago, we developed a way to sort through all the different opportunities that the Lord was giving to us. And they were all good things. But we took since I live in Detroit, we took an automotive approach. We said, okay, this is in our lane. We tried that, and that's got to go in the garage. We tried that. It's a good thing. It's in the off-ramp. And we've got some stuff that just needs to go to the junkyard. So you have to figure out how to have that freedom to say, here are the opportunities. How are we going to sort through them without the fear of failure? We can try things if they don't work, or if they do work and we simply don't have the capacity, we can just be honest about that. And the Great Commission is being fulfilled. And I think that's what we all want, along with the unhindered presence of Jesus. So there you go. All right. Now I'm going to just wrap this up and then we can open it up for questions. Looking at the time.
You're good. You're doing great.
All right. So where do we need to begin then? Here's the thing. The first step is that you could take the animal that you picked to your next session meeting next month. And you could say, this goofy guy, Roy Yanke from PIR Ministries, told me to write down this animal to describe our ministry culture. And I think I would like to share that with you. Now, you may not feel the trust to be able to do that. Okay, I understand. But take a shot and see where it goes with the discussion. You know, this is what we truly are. The other thing we can do is to share your sense of whether your church ministry culture is a good and safe place. Then ask the various ministry leaders in your church what their sense of that is. So you have written down yes or no. You could share that maybe around the session table, but then it might be really important to go to the children's church ministry leader or the Sunday school leader or the youth pastor and say, what do you think about this? Are we a good and safe place to do ministry? Is the culture healthy? So those are two steps that we can take. Both a little risky, but they're worth it. So thanks for listening. And I trust that this has been helpful to you and will be as we build these ministry cultures that are healthy for the Lord.
Absolutely. Oh, such good stuff, Roy. And a lot. I mean, my goodness, we could spend 3 hours unpacking this and telling stories and kind of having different case studies to dig into. I know that our viewers are really interested in practical guidance. So I liked that you gave those two very practical starting points, just maybe sharing some reflections from tonight and seeing what conversation that might stimulate on your session. One of the things that you talked about is, you know, just the importance in the sense of partnership that we want to have, you know, between the pastor and the ruling elders or a staff team or whatever group it is, that as we partner together in ministry, we have to really be relationally connected to each other. We need to know one another. What are some practical ways that you have seen sessions move toward becoming more relationally connected toward one another?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And we worked on that a lot when I was on session. So we spent a lot of time in proximity to one another. We were all in small groups. When I first became a ruling elder, the small group that we were part of had many of the elders who were part of the church. And so we were in proximity to one another. And then even on session, when that wasn't the case and small groups had been divided, we still had time together. These guys, our church, Grace Chapel, had to close because of COVID and everything else regarding that. But these men who I spent 15 years with are still friends that I stay in touch with. And we're still involved with one another. And so their proximity is really a big deal. We, and I don't know, many, some churches do this. We had meals together before our session meetings.
Yeah.
Just that time of fellowship around the table. There was really, our pastor, Doug Walker, really tried to acknowledge each person's giftedness and the wisdom that they brought to the table. He didn't have to feel like his voice was the only voice around the table. And anytime that someone felt like their voice was the only voice around the table, we were quick to call each other out on that. And there was
easier sure to do that when you've had that downtime together to just get to know each other as people and not just fellow decision makers.
Yeah, exactly right. You know, you can look each other in the eye and go, really? Really? So those were some of the things, you know, that contribute to that. We, proximity, the actually being together is the key, I think, to that partnership of knowing one another and being able to build that.
I agree. I think table fellowship is so valuable, you know, like you said, having meals together. I've heard of a couple of sessions that we'll have two meetings per month rather than just one. One is the kind of the regular session meeting that we would think of, but the other meeting they have every month is dedicated to Bible study or book study. Just, you know, equally as important, equally as deserving of their time. And I think it's really cool to hear these different creative ways of really building that relational structure, that foundation with each other. Another question for you. You know, we talk a lot about how important it is to know how to manage conflict. And I liked at one point you talked about making conflict work for us, recognizing that it can be used as a tool for discernment if we handle it properly. What are some resources out there that you would recommend if people are identifying, you know, this is an area where they really want to grow either individually or grow as a session? What are some resources you would recommend for healthy conflict management?
Okay. So One of our staff members wrote a book on conflict called When Christians Clash. It's out of print, but I think we still have a few copies around if somebody wants to reach out to us and give that. But there are good books on conflict that you can study together and work through. There are some assessments. I'm trying to remember. I should know this off the top of my head. There is an assessment out there that will, in a quick way, reveal your conflict style, and to be able to take that as a session and then share it with each other about how that it's like, oh, okay, that's why that happens. Okay, so there are some of those tools, and I will have to come up with that.
One that I was thinking of is the peacemaker material from Ken
Yeah,
Sandy
absolutely. Yeah.
is one possibility as well.
Yeah, and
And
his new stuff, RW360, Relational Wisdom 360, is really powerful to go through together to talk about self-awareness, other awareness, and God awareness. That's the three things that he works around with that, and to
excellent.
discuss that together and work through it. So, yeah.
We had a follow-up question here from one of our viewers asking, in your situation where you experienced proximity in the relationship with the other elders, were there both men and women?
Unfortunately, in our situation, we had not gotten there yet. We were where we are. We're shared leadership in that way, and I say that unfortunately. Yeah, so it was just a bunch of us guys. But I don't think so. In the makeup of PIR's leadership, this all staff that are invited, all people, whether volunteer or actually paid staff, are invited to the table each month at our staff ministry staff meetings, and everybody has a voice around the table, and so we, it's, I would believe that we would have handled it well. We just never got there. Yeah.
Very good. Oh, let's see. I had so many possible follow-up questions here. I'm having to decide which ones. I do want to dig into this one a little bit. You talked about the importance of creating and fostering an environment where it is safe to admit mistakes and safe to confess sins. And I think we would all, hopefully we would all acknowledge, as we proclaim the gospel of grace, we want our ministry teams to be a place where we're also living by that same gospel of grace in the way that we relate to one another. And yet, how can we foster that, grace-saturated environment while at the same time upholding the high biblical standards that we believe in for church leadership? How do we hold those two together?
Yeah. So a different question that I might ask in regard to that is, which biblical standards are we talking about? Because when we talk sometimes about biblical standards for leadership, we're simply looking at the things that Paul talks about, in terms of qualifications for elders and deacons and all the rest of that. And we're also talking only about, in many cases, the moral standards, okay? Which are important. I'm not saying they aren't, but there are other standards as well, which have to do with kindness and compassion and what Galatians 6:1 talks about in terms of if you see someone who is surprised, overtaken, depending on how you translate that Greek word, by sin, that you who are more spiritual, I don't think it says more spiritual, but those of you who are not at that place, you are to attempt to restore them. And then also pay attention to the fact that this may not be your situation, he says later, but watch out lest you be tempted. You have to know that that's part of all of our brokenness, that we all have areas where we are going to be tempted to fail and to step outside of what God intends for us. But to make, in my estimation, because of the work that we do, to simply make a fortress, if you will, out of certain biblical standards or our sense of, you can't step outside of this, certainly does a lot of harm in my mind to the gospel. And certainly, how far, what is, there are things that are simply mistakes, right? simply oversights, misjudgments, all that kind of stuff. And those tend to, unfortunately, do tend to escalate into like the thing that we're talking about. You know, the Apostle Peter didn't sleep with anyone, and yet his failure was monumental. And Jesus saw fit not only to know that ahead of time and still be committed to Peter, but then also to restore him. Now, it wasn't pretty in any sense. And certainly in any of these areas where someone who is part of a leadership team really needs to step away, maybe for a time, and maybe because returning to a leadership position could not only harm the church, but also harm them. That needs to be done in an advocacy way, not in a judicial way. That we're actually advocating for the soul of this person. We're trying to figure out what's best for them as well as for the church, and not simply how we avoid messy situations.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Not just image management for the church,
right.
but actually addressing the soul that is in need of the gospel, in need of healing.
I ran across this comment from Augustine, or Augustine, depending on your pronunciation. He says, there is no truer test of the spiritual person than his treatment of others' sins with the call to deliver.
Wow.
I think that's really important.
Read that again.
There is no truer test of the spiritual person than his treatment of others' sins with the call to deliver.
Yeah. Well, it makes me think about, you mentioned Galatians 6:1 already, but Paul talks about, you know, when we are in that position of needing to correct one another, having that spirit of meekness.
Yep.
Having our own power under control,
mm-hmm.
and not getting carried away in a different way.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Got a question here from one of our viewers, back to kind of looking at the relational dynamics of the session. He wrote, given the tendency to be businesslike as a session, how do you recommend training in more of a shepherding model?
Yeah.
I have one idea I want to share after you share what
it.
You have.
Go for it.
Well, one thing that I think is kind of low-hanging fruit that a lot of people don't do, but we could do, is just model it with each other. So you know, if you're in a solo pastor situation, that the pastor would model the kind of shepherding they want to see happening from the elders to the congregation to the elders. So, you know, figuring out a way that it's workable, that makes sense to be meeting with the elders as a shepherd, checking in on their souls, checking in on their families, being in prayer for them. I think that's an easy one there. If we can model it, find a way to model it with one another is helpful.
Yeah, and we don't often think in those terms as pastors, as teaching elders, that the first circle for us beyond our families are our elders, are our partners in this ministry, and investing in them and in their lives and in their growth as disciples. You know, we tend, and it's unfortunate, but it's true, we tend to think beyond that out to the congregation. Our business work is being done in order to affect growth in the congregation. Well, you know, it has to start among us. And what you're saying is absolutely true. If a pastor will invest that way and model that, I think that's a great starting place for this to happen. I don't think, in light of that, I don't think that we can fall back on simply books and workbooks on information about how to shepherd. We have to see it and feel it and then be invited into the very same kind of thing with one another.
And the hard thing is, a lot of us don't know what we're missing because we haven't had a chance to see it or receive it. So it does take an outside catalyst, maybe to spark that vision or raise the question. But one person can be the catalyst for one church's session.
Yeah,
It
absolutely.
can grow quickly from there,
For sure.
just from asking a good question.
Questions are great. Being curious about each other, finding out about what baseball team the person likes, and you can run the list. It's exhausting, the list. But it's just that posture of curiosity about another person and that hospitality that we make room for them in our hearts and say, I'm concerned about you. Whether we get the business done, the business will be the business. But ultimately, it's who we are and how we're becoming more like Christ together.
That's right. One of the other things that you talked about, Roy, was kind of our culture around work and our views of productivity. And you've said that one of the signs of unhealth is this kind of unrelenting pressure to produce. And so you've talked about the importance of things like a weekly Sabbath, opportunity for sabbatical for a pastor. How can we move toward a more gospel-centered view of our work and less of a works righteousness, around our productivity?
It is probably one of the most difficult things. We are really swimming upstream in so many ways when it comes to that, because our culture, the larger culture we are part of, values this almost above all else. The metrics that we use to measure effectiveness, achievement, all the rest of that, it is like standing in the wind, a 70 mile an hour wind, to move against that. But it can be done if we're willing. It's almost because it's like being in the pot, the frog in the pot. We almost don't even recognize it. And
Well, and we reward each other for getting it wrong on
oh,
this.
absolutely.
That's the hard thing.
Absolutely. And so all of this, it's insidious because it can make us feel worthy. It can make us feel like our work is really valued in achievement. Our staff is going through Carl Vader's new book on desizing the church. And he makes a very interesting study about meritocracy. And that we are a culture of meritocracy. In other words, you are defined by your achievement and your success. And that is right smack dab in the middle of most of our churches. We compare and we think we're less than the church down the street or that we see on the webinars. So we feel less than, so we will try harder. And try to make more of that. I think too. So I'm going to wax theological for just a moment. I think, of course, this is all rooted in the fall, in my estimation, because we started out trying to make stuff happen on our own. And that just has carried through, it just carries through everything. So we're really working against not only the larger culture that's infected by sin, but even our own nature that's under reconstruction by the Spirit. So here's an interesting quote by Dallas Willard. It turns out that what you really think about Jesus is revealed by what you do after you found out that you don't have to do anything. Okay. So it's really important. Be more and do more are the twin pillars of our culture around us. So, how do we work against that? It takes time and it takes a willingness to do it. It takes self-awareness. Where does that tap into me and my desire to make things happen and to feel good about myself because of what I've accomplished, not simply
Right.
because of who I am?
Right. Well, and it's much easier for us to help one another in this area if we have really invested the time to know one another more deeply, to get
Absolutely.
beyond, here's what's on the written report, you know, here's how many people that showed up for this, here's how many Bible studies, you know, whatever it is, if we actually get beyond that surface level and have that strong, you know, relational trust, then we can help bring each other back to that gospel grounding where our identity really is located.
So if you go back, just one more thought on this, if you go back to what Jesus talked about bearing fruit, it's a great study to go through in light of this idea of productivity and achievement and valuing ourselves apart from who we actually are. And you see the organic nature of that, and it's all in relationship to him. So spending time in those kinds of places in scripture and really unpacking them can be helpful, I think, as well, to really get it to have a starting place to buck up against the cultural push that we have. So,
It'd be a great study for a session to do together.
yeah.
And I agree with you. I loved the point that you made. Let's see, where was it? Yeah, talking about encouraging each other's growth as disciples. That hopefully our time together serving in leadership would be a source of growth in our discipleship, that we would have the opportunity to delve into the scriptures together, and really apply, what does Jesus mean by apart from me you can do nothing? You know, what does he mean about abiding in him and then bearing fruit, not the other way around? And
Yeah. How often,
yeah.
so side note on that too, how often do we say those scriptures, right? And never take the time. We can read those, we can have somebody do a Bible study on that, and we'll hear it and all the rest of that, but we never really stop to ask the questions. What does that really mean? Without me, you can do nothing. How far does that go? Is there a line somewhere where that stops?
Right.
Those are the discussions that, if we can have those together and stimulate one another and encourage one another, and really can begin to go, oh, okay, I need to approach this differently.
Well, Roy, we are almost out of time. It just flew by. Oh, there was another good question that came in here. Let's see if we can wedge it in
We can
before we
squeeze
wrap
it
up
in.
tonight. Yeah, let's try. How do we get around the fear of loss of employment? This is so big. The fear of loss of employment when trying to create a culture of openness and vulnerability within our leadership. I wish we had a whole nother hour on that, because that's huge.
It
How do
is.
we get past that fear of losing our job when we try to move into this place of being vulnerable in our leadership?
Wow. So this is going to
Make sure you
sound.
have support. Number one, make sure you have support.
Yes, that is true. You don't want to do this only on yourself. So yes, so you want to create other advocates for this. So having these discussions, and you don't want to launch this, throw this grenade into the middle of the session table one day and say, this is who we are and what we're going to do. And you have to grow it slowly. It is the slow work of God. So you have to be committed to that one elder who you sense like, I can have that conversation with them and we can kind of explore this, and he can become an advocate with me in this. We can start having these conversations among ourselves. It's, again, it's not programmatic, it's organic. It has to happen that way. Otherwise, it will be a threat to
Right.
employment for sure. But the other thing too is, at some point we have to, we need to do that slow work, but at some point, push comes to shove, we've got to decide if it's good and right, we just need to do it. And we have to trust that Jesus is who he says he is. He sees us and he will walk with us through it. And it may mean we have to take a different direction.
That quote, you're never wrong to do the right thing.
And that's hard. It seems really easy to say across a, screen, but been there.
And I would just encourage too, if you're a pastor thinking along these lines and realizing that you maybe want to use your authority, your biblical authority grounded in the lordship of Christ in a healthy way to move things in a more God-honoring direction, not only to seek support within the session and look for people who will be open, but have a coach, have a spiritual director, have if your presbytery has a chaplain that's there to support the pastors, have somebody outside that leadership system that you can be processing with and getting input from, and make sure you're doing your own hard work, because when we face conflict, when we face resistance in leadership, boy, can it bring all kinds of other stuff to the surface for us. Previous experiences, trauma, just our own brokenness as human beings, ways that we respond to things that might be funky. So make sure you have support as you
Got to
press
have
in.
traveling companions. You really do.
That's
Yep,
right.
absolutely.
Well, speaking of that, one possible traveling companion is PIR Ministries. So, Roy, tell us how people can get a hold of you, or learn more about the services that PIR provides.
So PIRministries.org, all lowercase, one word, is the website. There's a lot of information there and a way to contact us through the contact page. If you're an EPC family member, I would be glad for you to email me directly at roy@pirministries.org, and we'll do the best we can to serve you in that way and help. So those are the places that people could start, and we're there for both TEs and REs. This workshop that I've done, as I said, it is a workshop that we've done in presbyteries across the EPC. Four TEs and REs together because we want them to have these kind of conversations.
Absolutely. And I would just add as well, if at any point I can be of assistance to you, your family, your congregation, you can also get a hold of me here at annie.rose@epc.org. Happy to share whatever resources we might have that would be available to help. But again, Roy, thank you so much for this wonderful presentation tonight. Friends, please be aware that Roy is happy to take this show on the road. So if you think that your presbytery or your session would benefit from this presentation, or maybe even a consult from Roy, please reach out to him directly. I know that he would be very happy to walk alongside you. And keep an eye out for future webinars in this series. We're wrapping up for 2024, but we're not finished. We're going to keep talking about all the topics that are important for you, for the health of yourself, your family, and your congregation. So stay tuned for new episodes coming out in 2025. And with that, Roy, would you close us in prayer?
Absolutely. And I would just say, as always, as we wrap up this season, it has been an absolute joy working with you. And I would echo that if people need to get in touch with someone who really cares and has the resources, you're the person. So
Oh, thank you, Roy.
let's pray. Thank you, Father. That through hard things, we grow. That it's possible to build a culture that honors you in health and thriving. We ask that you would give us the courage, the discernment, the grace with each other to move in that direction, trusting in your good, slow work, that it will make a difference, that our churches will become places of true health and life. And that your name would be glorified. Thank you for this time together, for everyone who is listening and has been a part of this. May your spirit encourage and strengthen them, not only today, but tomorrow, for the good works that you have prepared in advance for them to do. Thank you for this time. For Annie, my sister, and your grace and mercy and good work in her. May your name be lifted up. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Roy. Thank you, friends. Have a good night.